Yeah, thanks. Certainly a great pleasure to be invited here to give a plenary talk for the International Conference on Research, Science, and Popular Culture. And I, you know, when you saw the guitar up there, you might have thought David's going to go up there and then start rocking out. And no, I'm just going to give you a good old academic talk that's aimed, I guess, at the public as well, about my research into the topic of scientists who've worked as consultants for popular films. And you know, my goal in looking at science consultants was really to think about popular cultural texts as acts of science communication. So I spoke to a large number of scientists and filmmakers about their experiences incorporating science into cinema. And one of the things, you know, the scientists that I spoke with, they understood that popular cultural texts can impact real-world science and technology. Right? And that was one of the reasons why they became involved as consultants. Right? They wanted to influence the types of stories that are told about science through cinema. Now, the use of science consultants for movie productions and television has become incredibly popular within Hollywood. And I give you a number of examples up here. I don't know if I have a pointer here. If I touch this, it'll kill things. Nope, we got it. You get a lot of examples of a very recent film, films that have come out within the last 12 months. All of these have significantly involved the use of scientists as consultants. In fact, it would be really shocking, actually, to have a movie or a television show made in Hollywood that had any scientific content that didn't bring a scientist on board as an advisor. There are actually a number of recent initiatives coming out of scientific organizations that are trying to encourage the collaborations between scientists and entertainment professionals. The most prominent of these is the U.S. National Academy of Sciences, Science and Entertainment Exchange. Oh, Lord. Now, when I started looking at this phenomena of science consultants, right, the question I wanted to know right away, I mean, what does a scientist do for a filmmaker? And, you know, at first blush, right on the surface, that seems like a pretty easy question. Well, the scientist helps the filmmaker get the science right. Okay, but what do we mean by science? Right? When you start thinking about science as more than just a collection of facts in a textbook, right, you see that that's actually a far more complicated question than it first seems. What I really wanted to know was, what did a filmmaker consider sciencey enough that they required the use of an outside expert? Now, based on all those interviews that I did with the scientists and the filmmakers, I identified sort of six general areas in which scientists work with and help filmmakers during the production of a film. And here you see an example, astrophysicist Kip Thorne working with director Christopher Nolan on the film Interstellar. Now, of course, I'm not going to have time today to go over all six of those. I'm just going to go over a couple of them and give you a sort of feel for the complexity involved with scientists working on Hollywood film productions. Now, some of the most important people, and some of these people would think they are the most important people, working on a film set are the actors, right? And the actors, of course, they want to know from these scientists how they can go about portraying a scientist. And here we have a picture, again, a recent film, a film that's coming out either next week or the following week, in a week and a half, the film The Martian will be out. There's Matt Damon after spending a day at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena talking with scientists to help him portray a scientist in this film. But many of you hopefully are asking yourselves the question, what does it mean to act like a scientist? I mean, what really does that mean? Well, one significant element in acting like a scientist is the ability to pronounce scientific jargon. Right? So for many of these actors, scientific jargon, it's equivalent to a foreign language, really. So the consultants help these actors to pronounce difficult to pronounce scientific words like gamma globulin, right, or aerosolized, or pachycephalosaurus. Right? Those words, they don't just trip off the tongue. They're actually pretty difficult to say. Now, actors need to be able to say those words correctly because they have to convince the audience that they know what those words mean. Right? So if you can't pronounce a scientific word, you're not going to convince anyone that your character is actually a scientist. So scientific jargon, saying that, it's clearly important. In some ways, it's a practical, pragmatic issue. Teach me how to say that weird scientific word that you say every day. But what actors want even more than that, what they're really looking for, is something that will help them convey to the audience that the character they're playing is a scientist, right? Not a stockbroker, right? Not a lumberjack. It's a scientist. This, of course, is the concern that scientists have about the portrayal of scientists in movies and on television, right? That actors are relying on stereotypes so that they can quickly indicate to the audience, hey, this character, it's a scientist, wearing the white coat, frizzy hair, acting all crazy. But everyone in here, I'm sure, knows a scientist, right? At least I hope you do. If not, you could probably go to the department next door and meet one. You know that, you know, scientists, they're not that much different. They're actually not different from other people at all, right? Scientists are just regular people like everybody else. They got the same concerns as you and I, right? They got their family concerns, they got to pay the bills, they got to do the housework, they got to walk the dog, right? Scientists are just regular people. But the perception, of course, is that scientists have to be somehow different than everyone else. Now, I spoke with a paleontologist from the Smithsonian Institution who worked on the pre-production of Jurassic Park, very early on in the pre-production. He was brought in to speak with the script writers and some other members of the production crew. Now, this guy, he's a paleontologist, and he's the world's leading expert on iguanodons, right? These are duck-billed dinosaurs. And he thought, well, of course, they're going to come in here, they're going to ask me a lot of questions about dinosaurs, going to ask me about duck-billed dinosaurs, right? I'm the world's leading expert on that topic. But he said over 3 hours, they never even asked him one question about dinosaurs. All they wanted to know was how he, as a paleontologist, would react to various situations, right? How would he, as a paleontologist, react if he dug up this particular bone? Or how would he, as a paleontologist, react if he walked around a corner and saw a Tyrannosaurus Rex? Now, he told them, well, look, I would react the same way as everybody else. I'd drop a load in my trousers, and I would faint. But from their perspective, they wanted to say, yeah, but you were a paleontologist. Clearly, you would react differently from other people because they had that perception. But as I found when I interviewed all these scientists, I mean, it was difficult to tease out exactly what it was that made scientists different from everybody else. The one thing that I did find is that scientists are different in one key respect. They're motivated to do science, right? Actors want to know what motivates these people to spend most of their life not knowing things, right? Because as we know with science, you don't know things most of the time. You spend months and years not knowing until you can get an answer. Now, actors want to know, well, why is that? So Brian Cox from my own university, University of Manchester, worked as the science consultant on the movie Sunshine. And one of his jobs was to help the actors to understand what would motivate a scientist to go on what was essentially a suicidal mission to restart the sun. Now, the actors and the director, they said, well, they would be motivated by a sense of religious belief. But Brian, he's a member of the scientific community, says, well, that's not really motivating me. What he told them instead is that as a scientist, he would be motivated to take that mission because he understands that nature is more beautiful and complex than anyone can possibly imagine. That for him, The joy of doing science is to experience that unknown and then to be able to find an answer to that uncertainty. Then, of course, it's up to the actor to use their own skills to convey that down to the audience. So acting like a scientist, a bit more complex than just throwing on a white coat. But when I was telling people that I worked on this idea of science consultants working in Hollywood, most people at first thought, well, of course, they're there to go, you know, fact check a script, right? They're handed a script, they go through, make sure that the science in there is accurate. And fact checking is certainly one of the key duties for these science consultants. Every scientist I spoke with got a script and had to go through it. But that notion of getting the facts right was actually one of the biggest challenges that the filmmakers faced trying to use science in their movies. So most scientists that I spoke with, right, they believed that science was really rigid and that it was going to suck the creativity away. Right, because when we think about science, right, it is reality, right? That's reality with that capital R. So how could something that's so objective and rigid actually be used to make entertaining stories that are fictional? Well, the mistake that the filmmakers made is that they saw science as only a rigid collection of facts that gives a single answer. Right? Science is actually far more flexible than most scientists actually believe. So not every choice in science is that binary choice between accurate and inaccurate. Okay, that's sort of a false dichotomy often when we think about science. For one thing, there's a lot of uncertainty in science. Right? There's a lot of things we still don't know. There are a lot of things we can ask different scientists and they would give two different answers that would be equally valid because we just don't know at that particular time. Now, in addition, most natural phenomena demonstrate variability, right? Meaning that for a certain piece of natural phenomena, we can have multiple, a range of answers that could be equally valid in answering that. Now, it's that type of flexibility that science provides that allows these scientists to help filmmakers to create drama for their films. And the film Deep Impact is actually really interesting to think about in this regard. Neil deGrasse Tyson, celebrity scientist, he actually singled out Deep Impact recently as what he considers to be the most accurate science film he's ever seen. And from my perspective, certainly there were a lot of scientists involved in making that film, and the filmmakers definitely listened to their scientists and took them seriously. Now, for those who've never seen this movie or those who may have forgotten what the plot is, there's a big comet that's going to slam into the Earth, and we send out a team of astronauts to try and destroy the comet before it can hit the Earth. Now, for the filmmakers, they envision that those scenes as being the action scenes in the film. Those were the scenes they wanted to be the ones that were dramatic and exciting for the audience. The problem for them is they had no idea what a comet looked like. So they had to bring in a number of scientists to help them to make that scene more dramatic and exciting. So put yourself in the place of a filmmaker. You're sitting in one of these production meetings, you've got your scientists there, and you say, we need to know what the surface of a comet looks like. And one of the scientists says, okay, the surface of a comet, and so I'm going to give you two choices. You're the filmmaker, let me know which one you choose. Scientist number one says, well, we think that the surface of a comet might look like an egg, meaning it's very, very smooth. And our thinking behind that is that you might get structures that grow up, but there are things from space constantly hitting that comet, breaking them, gives you a very smooth surface. Okay, that's possibility number one. Scientist number two stands up and says, well, another potential idea is that the comet looks really rough and jaggedy with knife-like structures sticking up everywhere. And the thinking behind this is that, well, there's very low, almost minimal gravity on a comet. So you can get mineral structures that can grow up, look like little fairy tale castles. Okay. Who's going to choose possibility number one? Okay, good thing you guys can all still become filmmakers, right? Because possibility number two, that's what you're going to take. That's the most exciting, the most dramatic aspect. And the benefit, it's still accurate. You had two scientists saying, yeah, we could one or the other. Choose number two. You can still maintain that this is accurate. The other thing that the filmmakers wanted is, again, they wanted some danger to be added to this particular scene. What can be on that comet's surface that could add a sense of danger, a sense of risk? Well, the scientists told them, well, there are geysers on comets, and these geysers contain ice, and when the sun hits the ice, it sublimates. It goes straight to steam, and it shoots out. But that's only when the sun hits it. And the filmmakers said, well, that's great. So what we need is a rotation time that can give us some danger, right? So what if we took 4 hours? Every 4 hours, the comet hits the sun, and these geysers go off. And the scientists say, yeah, well, you know, the typical rotation time for a comet is 10 hours. And the filmmaker goes, yeah, but we want 4 hours. The scientists kept maintaining, the typical time is 10 hours. Finally, the filmmakers say, what's the range? Oh, the range is between 3 hours and 14 hours. Oh, so 4 hours is within that range. Yes, okay, so now you can use it and it's accurate. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you a brief clip from that film to show how the filmmakers took that information and turned it into a scene in the movie. So on this, they've landed on the comet. They're trying to drill down with a nuclear bomb. It gets stuck and danger occurs.
I think we better hurry, boys.
Sun's rising behind you. It's coming up fast.
Hey, shields down!
Oh, Christ.
Get the hell out of there!
Okay, so that scene's pretty exciting. The only reason it was that exciting is that they talked to scientists who gave them advice about how to make that scene dramatic. Okay, and this also points out that they were able to do this because the science was flexible, right? I mean, one of the things that I find in terms of people talking about accuracy in fiction is that it's a bit of a straw man, right? Because in this case, it's accurate because there were things we didn't know, and then we took advantage of natural variability. So it's important to remember, these aren't documentaries, okay? So as long as you stay authentic to the science, that's generally good enough. But what I also want to talk about that leads into the idea of when filmmakers are making these films, they want to be authentic, okay? They want to try and maintain as much scientific authenticity as they can. But there are reasons why filmmakers often can't make a film as accurate as possible. And many scientists who critique films and TV shows don't always remember that. So I'm going to show up an example here to start with. This is the 1929 film Frau im Mond, or Woman in the Moon. It was this guy here, that's Fritz Lang. This was his science fiction follow-up to his classic movie Metropolis. And Lang was adamant that this film was going to be the most scientifically accurate film ever made. So to that end, he hired a number of science consultants. That is Hermann Oberth, Hermann Oberth is a pioneering Austrian rocket scientist. He also hired Willy Ley. He was a popular science writer at the time. And they brought in the German Rocket Society to help as advisors on this film. So what we're going to do is we're going to watch a clip here. And I know you guys aren't rocketry or astronomy experts, but I want you to see if did Lang get his film 100% accurate or not. So in this clip, they've landed on the moon, and this scientist wants to go look for water. Yeah, so it's pretty hard to claim your film's the most accurate film ever made when characters run around on the moon without their space suits, right? Now, the issue wasn't that Lang didn't value the advice of his scientists, right? It was that Lang understood that in 1929, portraying the moon without an atmosphere was not practical from a filmmaking perspective. Now, for one thing, box office concerns dictated to him that this film was going to be a love story. And he didn't think spacesuits would be very conducive to that aspect of the story. And his quote is, quote, "How can I present a love story taking place on the moon and have my two leads holding hands and kissing while wearing diving suits?" But the more important part is that this was a silent film, right? And if you've seen a silent film, and as you've seen just here, the ways in which the actors convey emotions and their state down to the audience is through their facial expressions. That's why they have those sort of really exaggerated facial expressions and exaggerated movements. You need to see the characters' faces, the actors' faces, in order to see them act. If they're wearing diving suits, you can't see that. So that was a filmmaking constraint, right? It was a technical limitation. Meaning, no matter how much Lang wanted to adhere to scientific accuracy, the technology of 1929 just wouldn't let him do that. Now, technical limitations, that's just one filmmaking constraint that filmmakers run into when they try to incorporate science into cinema. In the end, these filmmakers have to use their own expertise. It's what I call an entertainment expertise to determine if and how science can actually be used in the context of these constraints. But what I want to do now is to examine a case where scientists worked with the filmmakers to help them overcome those constraints. So for these positive collaborations, right, it's not about telling the entertainment professionals you're wrong. It's about providing realistic alternatives to the filmmakers so that they could replace any elements that you are critiquing. So we're going to look at Jurassic Park. The scientist who was the consultant on all four Jurassic Park films, including this summer's big hit Jurassic World, Jack Horner, there and there. He's a paleontologist from the Museum of the Rockies. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you two film clips. The first film clip is from what's called an animatic. And for those who don't know, an animatic is like a three-dimensional storyboard, right? It's a way for the filmmakers to block scenes, to figure out where they want actors to stand, where they want the special effects go, lighting, that type of thing. So this animatic is done in stop motion, and it's the famous scene in Jurassic Park where the velociraptors go into a kitchen. And what I want you to look at, or think about, is what might be scientifically inaccurate about the dinosaurs in this animatic. Okay. Any guesses what might be inaccurate about those dinosaurs?
The size?
The size? Yeah, potentially the size might be, but they were willing to live with that for sure. Anyone know anything about dinosaurs? I see someone doing the door motion. Does he open? Does anyone here have a dog? Yeah, if you have, a dog could easily open that as well, so a dinosaur could probably open that. What's the dinosaur doing with its mouth?
The tongue,
yes, the tongue flicking.
Tongue flicking.
Yeah, tongue flicking. Dinosaurs don't do that, right? So the scientist, Jack Horner, when he saw this, you know, what's that?
Reptiles do it. Snakes do it.
Snake tails, and that's exactly the point. Horner saw that and said, dinosaurs don't do that, right? And the reason why he says that is that he wants to convince the audience that dinosaurs are more related to birds than they are to snakes and reptiles. So from his perspective, that's actually a horrible representation because that's convincing the audience, oh yeah, they're related to snakes really clearly because they're flicking their tongue like that, right?
Have you ever seen a bird with teeth?
Birds have, they do have, in their genetics, they actually have proto teeth.
But not evolved ones.
Yeah.
It's a very evolved creature, so maybe the radiation in systematic allows that.
Yeah, it's possible. I mean, I don't want to have the bird dinosaur debate. I mean, my point is saying that this paleontologist, Jack Horner, from his perspective, he wants to convince the audience that birds are related to dinosaurs. So therefore, he gets really angry about this. And I should say, you know, he got angry, but what he did instead is he said, well, look, I don't like your tongue flicking, so I'm going to give you an alternative. In fact, I'm going to give you two possibilities to use for that scene to replace that tongue flicking that you see that you seem to like. So there are two pieces of advice that he gave them that you're going to see in the final scene here. Okay, so what two things do we think were added there? The sound, the communication? Yeah. Well, or just the idea of communication as well, that noise, right? He said, look, these guys that can communicate with each other, make them do that thing. It's a real scary sound. Okay, second thing?
But there's a second one.
Well, yeah, they added another one. They doubled it, yeah, that double danger. But they could have added 10, I suppose, but the breath coming out, right? And the breath coming out, again, reinforces for Jack Horner the relationship to birds, because only warm-blooded animals would be able to do that. And also, it's a spooky scene, right? It's a really nice visual. You snort, covers it up, and then it disappears and you see the dinosaur. In fact, if you look at reviews of this film, that was actually pointed out by people, and they say, Spielberg, done it again. You know? But the reality is that came from the scientist. So both sides very happy with this collaboration. The filmmakers, they get this visually interesting and dramatic scene, and the scientist tries to put in the scientific authenticity. But as we've already sort of discussed a little bit, I have a second reason for using this, right? There's a question that I want to finish my talk off with, is thinking about what do these scientists get out of working with these filmmakers, right? Why do they spend a lot of time working with the filmmakers. In Jack Horner's case, it was a conscious choice to promote or disseminate the idea that dinosaurs were more related to birds than they are to lizards or reptiles. Okay? And that was a controversial idea then, as we see here, it's still a controversial idea. So he was using a major Hollywood film to communicate ideas about dinosaur evolution. Now, this idea of why do these scientists become involved in these films, we could ask this as well of one of the other scientists I already talked about, Herman Oberth. Why didn't he just walk off that set? Why doesn't he just say, you're having characters walk around on the moon without spacesuits? I'm out of here. It's going to ruin my scientific credibility. Well, the reality is he actually did leave, and he was brought back. And why did he come back? Because he understood that that film could demonstrate the possibilities of rocket travel. He was hoping to get potential funders based on the depiction of the rocket in that film. And he actually did. After the premiere of that film, he got funders for his research. Unfortunately, I guess, those funders happened to be the German military, but the film actually played a role in getting that technology. So in essence, I find that scientists can create these depictions of future technologies that can stimulate a desire in the audience to see these potential technologies become realities. Right, so these fictional prototypes, I mean, they're what I refer to as diegetic prototypes. These fictional prototypes actually have an advantage even over a true prototype. Right? In the film, those technologies exist as real objects. People interact with them. They socially contextualize those objects in the film. Now, these fictional prototypes are what I refer to as pre-product placements. Right? Just as with a real product placement, the goal is to instill a desire in the audience to obtain that product. But the only way the audience can get that product is if they support its development in the real world. So there's actually a number of technologies where movie depictions played a role in getting the public excited to see these technologies become reality. So space films from Frau im Mond to the recent Interstellar to next week's The Martian, those films were really useful in exciting the public about space travel. This scientist here, John Underkoffler, we've heard about Minority Report a bit. He was the scientist responsible for coming up with that gestural interface technology. And that fictional tech prototype was so successful, it got him the money to make that real-world prototype that he then used to get a contract with the U.S. government. The film Big Hero 6, down there, actually contains a fictional prototype as its breakout character, right? The soft medical robot, Baymax. Lots of roboticists and engineers, including Sanam Siddharth, worked on that film with the goal of trying to get people interested in soft medical robots. So if you want to generate public excitement about your technological work, right, it's hard to beat having your technology featured in a major motion picture that wins an Academy Award. Now again, we can also ask why this scientist here, Ian Lipkin, he's the Center for Immunity and Infection at Columbia University, why would he take a month out of his schedule to work on a fictional movie? Well, you can see it in his quote right here. Okay, this is something that was alluded to a little earlier in Alexa's talk. He was hoping that this film would scare the public into providing more support to study the threat of emerging viruses. Now, I refer to this connection between the depictions of scientific disasters in movies and heightened public awareness as the War Games effect, right, after the 1983 film. And what I find is that scientists who work on these films, they're acting like the ghost of Christmas future, right, in the Charles Dickens novel, A Christmas Carol. So they're presenting audiences with really bleak visions of the future with the understanding that the public still has the opportunity to make sure that that future doesn't come to pass if they support the scientific issue, give it either more political, financial or scientific attention, right? And As I show here, and this came up earlier with Day After Tomorrow, that Alexa talked about earlier, lots of different issues have benefited from the War Games effect. I got Dr. Ehrlich's Magic Bullet. I could find earlier films going almost to the beginnings of cinema where scientists became involved because they wanted to raise awareness. And as Alexa talked about earlier, you know, the impact of these films on the public, you know, that's debatable. The one thing that they are successful at doing is raising awareness. Okay, and that's why these scientists often become involved in making these films. All right, now the final thing that I wanted to mention was the idea that scientific organizations often become involved in making films because by giving access to their scientists and their facilities, in exchange, they get to control how their institution is represented in a major motion picture. So they get to have their name or their logo utilized up there on the screen. Twister, for example. The National Severe Storm Laboratory, they were brought on board as the science consultants for that film. And they got the script, they looked through it, and imagine their surprise when they realize they are actually the bad guys. They are the well-funded governmental bad guys in the script. So they go to the producer and, you know, they have a conversation a little bit like, you want us to be your science consultants? You make us the bad guy? I mean, really? So they changed it, and now they become, not necessarily the heroes, but they become the hero's helping hand in the film. Now, I'm also going to mention the case of NASA, right? So any financial and material resources that NASA spent helping the producers of a lot of films like Space Cowboys or Armageddon or Deep Impact or recent films like Interstellar, and again, next week's The Martian that NASA also helped with. I mean, any resources they spent making that film are insignificant in light of the publicity value they gained from having flattering depictions in those movies. So I'm going to finish here by showing a film clip from Dante's Peak, essentially explaining why it was good for NASA to be involved in the making of that of this film. So in this clip, the hero, played by Pierce Brosnan, he's lost. It's been a volcanic eruption, and a piece of NASA technology helps find him.
Nancy.
Thank you.
Frank? Yeah. How long's this light been blinking?
I don't know, day or two?
Thank you, NASA. Thank you, NASA. Thank you, NASA. Thank you, NASA!
Thank you, NASA. Right? You can't put a price on that type of publicity. Right. It can have a major impact on the way in which the public views your organization. So to conclude, I find that science consultants are beneficial both for the scientific community and for the entertainment industry. Right. So science consultants can help these filmmakers use authentic science to make their films more dramatic, interesting, and entertaining. But it's also the same case that these stories that are told about science in movies can convey the excitement of scientific research and communicate a sense of awe about the natural world and especially about our ability to understand the natural world. And that is a good thing. Thanks.